Random House Audio presents Adventures from the Technology Underground. Catapults, Pulsejets, Railguns, Flamethrowers, Tesla Coils, Air Cannons, and the Garage Warriors Who Love Them. By William Gurstelle. Read for you by Marc Cashman. Preface. A physical experiment which makes a bang is always worth more than a quiet one. Therefore, a man cannot strongly enough ask of heaven. If it wants to let him discover something, may it be something that makes a bang. It will resound into eternity. George Christoph Lichtenberg. This book takes its name from Fyodor Dostoevsky's book, Notes from the Underground. Dostoevsky's underground is a dark cellar from which a nameless underground man writes his journal. A place both physically and philosophically apart from society's mainstream. And that's the way he wants it, because out of the mainstream, he can exert his own individuality. This is the only place where he can demonstrate that he is a creative and unique human being, with creative and unique ideas, and, most of all, a distinctive self. Writing of his normal employment, the underground man states, "I had a sickly dread of being ridiculous, and so had a slavish passion for the conventional in everything external." But underground, he can open up his creative side. He can be as articulate and understandable and self-revealing as he desires. Dostoevsky's underground is a dark, serious, and humorless place, which makes it much different from the technology underground, the general term used throughout this book to describe the society of amateur inventors and scientific enthusiasts whose activities are profiled here. The technology underground is a buoyant place, full of enthusiasm, joy, and camaraderie. Still, the word underground fits both places well, for several reasons. The technology underground provides the same sort of opportunity for expression as the windowless cellar provides for the underground man of St. Petersburg. This is an important similarity. In the underground, all are free to express themselves without reserve, whether expression occurs through words or actions, through journals or through orthogonal machine layouts and bolted steel constructions. This is a place of alternative, clandestine, anti-establishment, and semi-subversive culture. The possibilities and potentials inherent in this type of self-directed science and technology are the foundations for the creations of intelligent, innovative, and often slightly strange men and women who have their own notion of the best use of free time. The people profiled here do what they do largely without regard to economics, profit, government regulation, corporate or academic practices, or even good taste. Most laws, except for those of physics, regulations, and building codes, are skirted or ignored. You can do that in the technology underground. Here, no one ever needs to justify his or her actions on the basis of normality or financial return. And no one needs to fear being ridiculous. Introduction. The Technology Underground. This book is about the art and science of making catapults, pulse jets, flamethrowers, Tesla coils, high-voltage electrostatic machines, high-power amateur rockets, air cannons, railguns, fighting robots, magniformers, and more. It is as much about the people who make them as it is about the culture that engenders their creation. This book is the end result of a long and detailed exploration, a result of 2 years spent spelunking in the technology underground. The knowledge for making devices such as these is not taught in any school, shared in instructor-led seminars, or obtained by reading mainstream science textbooks. Rather, this knowledge is acquired only by consorting closely and directly with ardent technophiles in their workshops and labs, by commingling with them at their competitions and gatherings, and by participating in obscure, subject-specific internet chat rooms. Most of all, it is attained by using one's own eyes, hands, and brain to weld, machine, solder, bend, drill, plumb, design, break, tweak, experiment, and tinker. It requires spending more money than one would think reasonable on a hobby, and risking more of life and limb than a loved one would think prudent. In short, it requires a determined and long-term exploration of the technology underground. What is the technology underground? When is something a part of the technology underground? It is reasonable to outline, at the outset of a conceptualization or a project, the rules of conformance. Not every piece of interesting technological fabrication or eccentric scientist's folly belongs in the technology underground. There is a large number of possible candidates for inclusion. If the definition is stretched too far, the idea loses meaning. The boundaries become too dim and porous. So, definitions and qualifications of a sort are required. The changing nature and the continuous introduction of ever newer technologies makes it a bit problematic to determine which projects belong and which do not. However, for the purposes of writing this book, the extreme and radical tinkerers of the underground and their inventions all meet five conditions. These qualities are the membership criteria, the admittance ticket to the TU. 1. Projects are founded upon physical sciences. All experiments, inventions, or projects of the underground are ultimately based on the work of physical scientists. Such projects use Newtonian physics and Faraday-style electricity and magnetism. This means that the projects here are built upon the science of men such as Archimedes, Galileo, Maxwell, Faraday, and Newton. These projects are typically much closer to the hammer, wrench, welding rod, and soldering gun technologies of Thomas Edison, the Wright brothers, and Henry Ford than to the virtual computational machines of Bill Gates and John von Neumann. Footnote: The 10 most important scientists in history, according to writer Isaac Asimov, are 1. Archimedes for machines and mechanics. 2. Charles Darwin for theory of evolution. 3. Albert Einstein for theory of relativity. 4. Michael Faraday for electricity and magnetism. 5. Galileo Galilei for gravity. 6. Antoine Lavoisier for chemistry. 7. James Clerk Maxwell for electricity and magnetism. 8. Isaac Newton for laws of motion. 9. Louis Pasteur for immunization and pasteurization. And 10. Ernest Rutherford for atomic theory. Of these 10, only Archimedes, Faraday, Galilei, Lavoisier, Maxwell, and Newton have direct applicability to the material in this book. Einstein's and Rutherford's contributions were to theoretical physics, and Pasteur and Darwin's were to the biological sciences. 2. Amateur standing. These are the projects of amateur scientists and technology enthusiasts. Qualifying projects must be motivated by love, not money. The projects in this realm are the work of individuals or, at most, small groups. There are no large corporate R&D teams, no government-sponsored laboratories, and there exists no real hope to profit financially or recoup money spent. Here, technological prowess and profit have at best a distant relationship, and typically no relationship whatsoever. 3. Element of danger. TU projects are always edgy and often dangerous. While not every project described in these pages is overtly dangerous, in point of fact, the majority do have some risky aspect or involvement. Almost all have some hazardous detail, some threatening characteristic, some sharp, hard, pointy thing moving at high velocity, an exposed hot surface, or a high voltage shock risk. Always, there is some attribute that would cause your mother to prefer you trade participation in this activity for a safer one, say, steeplechasing or prize fighting. 4. High energy. Such undertakings almost always involve the creation of large amounts of kinetic energy. Most examples here involve something moving at high speed. In fact, there is almost always a boom to start matters off, a whoosh, and finally, a splat. In some cases, electrons or photons are used instead of more massive particles, but the high kinetic energy aspect is almost always present. 5. Recognition. These are social endeavors, not secret ones. The projects here are meant to be seen, criticized, and lauded. If recognition is not provided live and in person, then it exists through the internet, secondhand reports, and word of mouth. The underground existence is not a solitary one. Indeed, it is a vibrant community that celebrates its members. The attributes above provide a framework for determining when a work belongs and when it does not. Say, for instance, that two software developers design a video game involving death rays and flying cars. It has sexy graphics and lots of postmodern Armageddon-like sound effects. Does such a project belong to the technology underground? Probably not. While it may be worthy of recognition, and perhaps culturally edgy, there is no solid connection to the science of Newton and Faraday. Nor is there any real element of danger. And the energy levels never exceed the puny wattage levels needed to spray electrons over a television screen. Now consider a high-velocity electromagnetic pulse weapon developed by Lawrence Livermore Labs as part of a Defense Department initiative to research an anti-missile system. It certainly qualifies from a kinetic energy point of view, and its lineage from the work of Newton and the rest is clear. And it probably won't ever turn a profit unless Livermore branches out into international arms dealing. But it is not the work of amateurs, not by a long shot. And it is most likely a secret project, not a social one. Finally, consider a group of friends who decide to build their own submarine. A working two-person submarine is a mechanical project of great complexity. It must be carefully designed in accordance with the laws of classical physics and fluid dynamics in order to make it swim beneath the water's surface. It is certainly dangerous, perhaps even foolhardy, depending on the fabrication skills of the inventors. It is expensive and will likely never produce even a dollar in revenue, much less any profit. Such a project meets the subjective criteria outlined here and therefore belongs in the technology underground. Why is there no flying car in your garage? As governor, I shall seek investors who will bring their capital to Louisiana in an effort to design, develop, and eventually mass-produce an aeromobile. This vehicle, which would revolutionize transportation in America, would be a cross between an ultralight aircraft and an automobile. The intended purpose is to create the ability of liftoff.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.